All right, very great. This may be one of the more riveting videos that you've ever watched, so if you have the nerve for it. And I've been through quite an experience the last 24 hours, actually. And it's just what's going on is just a little bit, it's very wowish. Very wowish. So if you we can just settle in here, and I can relay what's going on. What's going on is extraordinary, very extraordinary. The Holy Spirit is orchestrating something that is just kind of staggering, very wowish. What happened was, last night I was very late at night. A post appeared on my Facebook timeline from a Facebook friend, and I said, "What is this?" And it was the thumbnail was a sort of a picture of a skateboard and some legs on the skateboard in it. And I said, "Oh, something about skateboarding. That's certainly interesting. I mean, Holy Spirit has me doing all this, got have me get a skateboard, and what am I doing? I have no idea, actually. What's going on here, and it's the Holy Spirit's having me get into something. I don't know what's going on, honestly." And so here is this YouTube, a link to a YouTube video that appeared on my Facebook timeline. A friend just posted it. And I said, "Well, what the heck? I got nothing else to do. Let me click on this." Fateful click. Auspicious click. Maybe the most auspicious click I've ever clicked. And something really clicked. And is this recording? It's not recording on. Okay. This is not great. It's not recording on the memory chip. I didn't push it in. Oh well, that's okay. We can adjust. We can adjust. I clicked on this video. And from this click, it's been a landscape change, a big time landscape change. We talk about landscape changes cause this tremendous wow, where we just say, "Oh my gosh, my life has just changed." So this was a life changing click. Okay, so what happened? It opened up this video on YouTube. I said, "Okay," so starts off, and then I see this guy skateboarding, and then he starts doing stuff, and I said, "What is this? What is he doing?" And he keeps doing stuff, and he keeps doing stuff, and I just like said, "What is going on here? Is this real? Is this what is this? Is a impossible. What is he doing? Who is this guy? What is?" And I just, it just blew my mind. It just blew my mind. I said, "What is going on?" So, being the way that I am, I said, "Okay, wow, this is a huge wow. I'm gonna dig into this. What is this?" From that, I started digging. And some amazing stuff came up. And to give you some background, it's really interesting here. There's an extreme corollary to what's going on here to our spiritual path, an extreme parallel here. The Holy Spirit is art masterfully orchestrating something here. And the Dharma Kings. And we're just along for this ride, and it is quite a ride that is taking place. It is so unexpected, so surprising, which is great. Now, skateboarding has been around since, I guess, the 1940s. It was kind of, someone put skates, I don't know. It wasn't well known hardly at all. It was no skateboard culture or anything. Skateboard culture really started in Southern California in the early 1960s. Jan and Dean Sidewalk Surfing might have been 63 or 64 came out. Grab Your Board and Go Sidewalk Surfing With Me, it might have been 64. Because it's based on the song Catch a Wave by the Beach Boys. It was the same tune, and then Brian Wilson gave it to Jan and Dean and give different lyrics. And it began catching on as a cultural phenomenon in the early, you know, first part of the 60s, first half of the 60s. And being here in California, I mean, you saw kids started, you know, the hardware store, Thrifty, started carrying skateboards. Someone's manufacturing in Southern California. I don't know who it was, Wham-O or Mattel, or who actually started manufacturing skateboards. I don't know. But, and you saw some kid riding this skateboard. So what the heck is this? Well, guess what? We bugged our parents. We got skateboards. So I started skating in the first half of the 60s. And we started making our own boards. We started, you know, tinkering with stuff and doing a lot of stuff with skateboards. We were into skateboarding. It was, you know, and so we, Northern California, we were sort of part of the first wave of skateboard culture in Northern California. I was part of that wave. And skateboard to school, skateboard here, skateboard there. And we were cruising and turning and going down hills and carving and doing 360s and you know, whipping the board back and forth to go. And we did everything we thought we could do. I spent a tremendous amount of time on a skateboard trying to figure out, you know, what could we do with a skateboard? I mean, we thought pretty much we figured out pretty much everything there was to do with a skateboard. We really were into it. And then about, I don't know, maybe 1972 or so, maybe I was kind of lost interest. I figured I've kind of done everything except, you know, what you could do, just more dangerous stuff like going down steeper hills and wiping out worse. And I said, I don't really want to get injured. So that was it. And so skateboarding sort of hit this sort of flat spot, and it just sort of didn't seem to go anywhere for a while. And my attention, you know, was shifted very much on spiritual truth, non-dual spiritual truth, which culminated in discovering A Course in Miracles in 1978. Very key date, 1978. And at that point, I was completely immersed in A Course in Miracles and learning the real truth about Jesus Christ and about God. And just, you know, that was just a mind blower, to say the least. Just so extraordinary. And I said, this is what I want to do with my life. It was obvious. So I stopped skateboarding, stopped surfing. I stopped surfing in 1975. And skateboarding probably stopped starting maybe 1972, something like that. So I skated maybe about 8 years or so. And, you know, really was pretty good at it. Not great, but pretty decent at it for that time. So since then, I've been immersed in profound spiritual studies. Very profound path. And becoming very, very, very familiar with it. With the whole cross training. I just have a 360 degree cross training perspective on it all. So I've gotten very, very, very decent at it, to say the least. Very proficient. Now, there's something else that happened in 1978. Involving what? Involving skateboarding. Involving skateboarding, 1978. A technique was discovered in 1978. And really, the full credit goes to someone who figured out how to do this trick on flat ground instead of a wall. There was vert skating was starting to go in swimming pools, and in Southern California they started realizing they could skate in abandoned swimming pools. So this vertical culture started taking off in the 70s, I would think, and it started to develop down there in pool skating. We kind of vaguely heard about that, but there were no abandoned pools up here in Northern California, and you know, it was just wasn't such a big deal up here. But in 1978, somebody figured out a way to do this technique on a skateboard to get the skateboard to go aerial in the air. And this started a completely new chapter in skateboarding that had not been present before at all. And this is called street skating, freestyles and street skating especially, with all the tricks that you see now on the videos. None of those tricks were done back in the 60s. None of them, basically, okay? I mean, we did spinners, 360, you know, some of that stuff. But as far as the basic, all the tricks you're seeing, no, we didn't have a clue. None of that took place, and we had no idea. I mean, so I've been pretty much in a cave. I mean, I've seen, you know, Tony Hawk is most famous skateboarder in the world, baby. He does all this vertical stuff going up a, you know, ramp and then gets aerial and stuff. Well, okay. I mean, you know, he's good at soaring. He's a hawk. He soars. And it's spectacular and people love it and all this kind of stuff. But it's the street skating that's so insane. And I've only, you know, I haven't really followed it very much at all. And I had no idea what they're really doing. You see some guys jump on a rail with their board and say, what? What are they doing? They're crazy. They're insane. But I really didn't understand what was going on. I just could not relate to it at all. I said, skateboarding we did, this, what is this? I don't understand it at all. So here comes this video. And lo and behold, it's a video of this man who invented this technique, named Rodney Mullen. Never heard of him. Never heard of this man. And he not only invented this technique called the Ollie, O-L-L-I-E. This is the thing where you somehow you hop up and the skateboard goes up in the air and you're up on the skateboard and you can jump over stuff. You can just jump over stuff. And then he went on to invent just, I don't know, 20, 30, 40 different amazing tricks that you just don't even know what he's doing. And you have to say he's the greatest skateboarder of all time, the godfather of skating, certainly modern skating. So you have to divide skating into the early era and then the Rodney Mullen era, actually. He started a completely new chapter in skating, actually. And it's so amazing that what came before and what's come after is so different. This one invention just completely changed skating. And I didn't even know about that. You know, I didn't even know what this trick was or anything. So here I come upon this video where it's showing like the best, I mean, what he's doing, that just, it's just completely amazing. So I started looking into what's going on here. What is this? How one person could so revolutionize something is truly astounding. And what I found out was that he has been voted the all-time greatest action sport athlete in history, the greatest ever in action sports. Yet I'd never even heard of him. And you probably haven't heard of him either. And what he does is simply seems completely surreal, actually. Completely surreal. I mean, you talk about a savant. You talk about a genius, a savant. It's just mind-blowing, absolutely, watching that. So there's a lot of videos on YouTube with millions of views. I mean, he you know, he is just the god of skateboarding, you know, you might say. Yeah. So this man came along and just absolutely revolutionized skateboarding. And those of us were the early skateboarders who didn't keep up with it. Most of us didn't. We don't even know about this, really. You know, just very vaguely, we see these crazy kids, you know, jumping over stairs or something. What are they doing? Like, are they crazy? What are they, how do you even know what they're doing? You know, it's just bizarre. Just bizarre, like they're aliens or something. Well, not really. They grew up knowing what this trick was called the Ollie. How to get your skateboard to pop up in the air and like it's flying. I'm starting to study this, say what is this? I'm digging into it and studying it, and I'm trying to get instructional, like, how do you do this? I don't know. I mean, I look at the instructions and say, do this, and jump up and hit the bottom of the back end of the board and then drag your foot and it pops up in the air. And you see these kids doing it. And I say, what are they doing? It seems like impossible. It seems like they're defying gravity. It's like they're doing something that you shouldn't be able to do. And keep in mind, all those skateboarders before in the 60s and early 70s up to 78, not one ever did anything like that. Nobody knew how to do that. This man, and there's one other, his nickname was Ollie, who did it off a wall, but this man invented how to do it in flatland. Before that, nobody knew how to do this at all. And isn't that amazing? And so here we are, skateboarders, the earlier skateboarders were thinking, oh yeah, we did everything there is to do. We know what it's about. We know what it's about. And now I'm like coming out of a cave and saying, whoa, you know, I don't know anything. I don't know anything of what it's about right now, actually. I'm ignorant of it. Ignorant. Very ignorant. However, I said, I took it in the right way. I said, oh, wow. 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 Now, the Holy Spirit for the last year has been telling me, you got to learn to leap up in the air. And I said, what are you talking about? And the Holy Spirit's been saying, no, come on, you got to do this. So I've been trying to strengthen my legs so I can jump. And it keeps saying, yeah, you got to be able to jump up. And I just couldn't understand. Why am I doing all this? I don't know. And interestingly enough, to do an ollie, you have to be able to jump up in the air. Spring up in the air. That's the key to it. And I realized this and got from the videos instructions. It's like you gotta be able to crouch and then spring up. I said, that's what the Holy Spirit's been trying to teach me for a year. What is going on here? I'm supposed to learn how to do an ollie. How can a 60-year-old learn how to do an ollie? I mean, this is something that the kids do, like cats. You know, like to spring up in the air, it's just like bizarre. It's like pulling yourself up by the bootstraps, and yet they're doing it. So it must be possible to do this. Doesn't seem possible, and yet it must be possible. Now, I liken this situation in skateboarding to religion and Christianity. Let's use Christianity as a good example. There's all these Christians in the world. They think they know Jesus Christ. They think they know God. They think they know the Holy Spirit. They think they know it all. This is very similar to us early skateboarders. We thought we knew it all. Yeah, we thought, we're skateboarders. We've done everything. We've you know, that's it. There's nothing more to do, and we know what skateboarding's all about. And Rodney Mullen is like A Course in Miracles. A Course in Miracles comes along and just revolutionizes religion and understanding of Jesus Christ and God and the Holy Spirit. Revolutionizes it. And those of us who grew up with A Course in Miracles, as I have, we have just this radically advanced understanding of Jesus Christ and God and the Holy Spirit. Just like Rodney Mullen has this, you know, and the new skaters, the new wave of skaters from 78, they're talking about freestyle. They just have this radically advanced capacity that is just extraordinary. We could never even imagine the stuff they do. And it's just so extraordinary. Give them their due. So this is like A Course in Miracles. So the Christians, Christianity, they who don't even know about A Course in Miracles, they can't even imagine what we're able to do. They can't even imagine it, hardly at all. Just vaguely, like vague, but because they think they know it all. They think they've done it all, know it all, and there's nothing new under the sun. But Jesus Christ came back and gave us this better perspective, a way super advanced perspective, just like Rodney Mullen came along and just revolutionized skating, just blew everyone's mind. He really did. And the kids picked up on it, and they said, okay, this is what he's doing, I'm going to learn how to do that. And they followed in his footsteps like that. Well, A Course in Miracles is a radical, radical advancement in theological understanding. It's an extraordinary advancement. And those who are aware of this and really studied it and taken it to heart, you know, we're able to put our minds, you know, in all sorts of ways that the older crowd who doesn't know about this just can't seem to do that at all. It's like we can ollie, which is skateboard jumping over everything, and we can do this and just jump. I could just jump over anything. I can spiritually, I can just leap over everything. It's easy for me. So if spirituality was skateboarding, I'd be like an advanced skateboarder. Pro skateboarder, able to just do all these tricks and leap over all this stuff and you know, not crash, not have troubles, and be able to handle it all smoothly and easily. Thing about Rodney Mullen is he hardly ever fell. He did it so smoothly. It was all easy. It was just like the most insane dancing and balancing and acrobatics and coordination that you've ever seen. I can't even fathom, you know, how he does this. It's just surreal. So it's a wonderful corollary to what's going on in religion, what's going on. So I'm out here today, I'm saying, oh, how in the world can a 60-year-old do an ollie on a cruiser? I mean, are you kidding me? I got this cruiser because I just said I was going to be cruising, but then I didn't realize that there's actually a way to do this. I just thought it was telekinesis or something. I just couldn't understand. I said, it's impossible what they're doing. I still cannot understand it, how the board gets airborne like that. It just doesn't seem to... but they do it. They do it. So I'm thinking, okay, let me see if I can learn how to ollie. Because this is really the absolute necessary foundation of modern skating. If you cannot ollie, you can't do modern skating, street skating at all. You'll just be cruising. You'll be an old cruiser just cruising on the sidewalk, you know, and going back and forth. And that's it. But you're not going to be able to carve your way through streets and, you know, jump over curves, jump off curves, jump up onto curves, jump over cracks in sidewalks. I mean, nothing slows these guys down. They just jump over everything. They just get the board airborne and just go right over it. It's just like, and then all the tricks they do are just mind-blowing. So you have to master this ollie, this one technique. So I was trying today to do a few things, and I'm just like, are you kidding me? Kick the heel of the board down. Okay, push the heel of the board down. Slide your foot up, huh? You know, jump up. What? Nothing's happening. And this is crazy. It's like magic almost. I mean, nothing's happening. So now, it's like Christians trying to understand A Course in Miracles, or those who understand A Course in Miracles, they just say, what are you talking about? We can't do that. We can't think that way. We can't believe that way. We can't, because they're not up to speed on you know the right spiritual focus, the right spiritual technique, the right spiritual practices, the right spiritual theology, all of that. They're just not up to speed on it at all. So, now if I can learn how to ollie, Christians can learn about A Course in Miracles, and more to the point about Jesus Christ, the real Jesus Christ, and the real God, and the real Holy Spirit. Because really, they don't know. They really don't. They just have a foggy notion. They don't really know. And so it's very, very stifling and prosaic, and there's just really no free-flowingness at all in culture. Very much behind the times. So what am I going to do? Well, what are Christians going to do? What are religious people going to do? They're very much stuck in false theology, false understanding of Jesus, falsity, so much falsity, actually. Coming, they have to understand, where did that come from? Well, the ego. Okay, what's the, why is the ego? What's this? You know, and gradually you have to start working on it. Now, for me, how do I work on trying to be like a street skater? It seems like an impossibility for a 60-year-old. I said, well, let me see what I can do. And I would say the first thing is I have to be able to leap up. And they say you have to put your knees up to your chest. You really have to be able to crouch and then leap up and then put your knees up towards your chest to get the height. And so I can at least practice that. Now the Holy Spirit found me this little trampoline that I can practice on to start getting vertical springing ability. Sure, I can work on that. So I see, you know, some things that I could do. I'm working on my balance. And what I will do is I'll put a skateboard without wheels. I have just a, what do they call it? A board. just a board without wheels, without trucks and wheels. Practice leaping up from that and then landing on it. Leaping up and landing on it. So just, you know, so start breaking the whole thing down into smaller subcategories of I can learn how to do this, I can learn how to do this, I can learn how to do this, I can learn how to do this. And gradually build up confidence. It's not going to happen overnight. So this is a big challenge for me. I was just going to write it off, say, it's ridiculous, I can't do that. But I said, wait a minute. If I'm asking Christians and religious people in general to find out the truth about God, because they certainly don't know. They do not know. The truth about Jesus Christ, they don't know. They've just learned what authority has told them. And the authority has just used it as a control system. They're not telling them the truth about Jesus or God at all. And how it really works. And there's some who have some understanding. Just like skateboard, we could do some stuff. You would balance and skate and do 360s. And so we could do some stuff. But we really don't have the escape velocity. And spiritually, we don't have escape velocity to escape the clutches of the ego. Traditional religion doesn't have escape velocity. It just makes you feel good, like, well, I'm thinking about God. I'm you know, hoping that things work out for me. And there's no real technical understanding of it, no real nuts and bolts understanding of it all. In traditional religion, not at all. Here, we've gotten into the real nuts and bolts of it, how it really works, flipping the script in so many ways. Just like in skateboarding, they're able to flip the board in so many different ways. Here, we're able to flip the script in so many ways and just flip it here, flip, 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 flip. And I think traditional religious people are just like, you know, what are you doing? I have no idea. So it's a very strong corollary. It's like watching some really good freestyler or street skater doing all this stuff, and you just say, what? You watch Rodney Mullen, and you say, what? I have no idea what he's doing. It's just, he somehow lands on his board. I don't understand this. What in the world? It just seems almost impossible what he does. And yet, Smooth as could be, like, that's no problem. So when we're here flipping the scripts, flipping this, flipping, 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 I think we, traditional religious people, just, you know, say, what's going on? This is just, it seems so easy, but for us, it's like impossible. How can you just easily breeze through all this, you know, just, no problem. Well, complete dedication for 40 years. With the right understanding, some of the basic understanding, full stop and the wow practice is like the ollie. If you don't know how to do full stop and the wow, you can't do all the rest of the flip scripting, because you'll take the truth as an abyss. You'll think the truth is an abyss trying to threaten and destroy you. And so you'll just develop defenses against it, mental defenses against it. So you have to do full stop in the wow. It's like the crucial technique, spiritual technique, that's been around for thousands and thousands of years. Without this technique, you just are just going to be stuck. You're going to take the ego as if the ego were God, and then interpret Jesus in an egoic way. So obviously an egoic God is going to create an egoic Jesus, right? And an egoic Holy Spirit. And so the whole thing becomes just this, an ego trip. But when you can do full stop on the wow, and you understand it, you get it, I can do it, then any and all insights arise, and you know what to do. You won't be overwhelmed by them. You know what to do. And so you get used to all the script flipping that goes on, and you're able to turn all this falsity right side up and get it clear. So there's just an amazing parallel here between full stop on the wow and the ollie, which is the key to all this modern skating that they do. Popping, all the popping. It's just, you know, they're so good at it. It's artistry. Action sport artistry of fabulously coordinated and timing, just wizardry, you know, as far as their timing goes and the coordination and the deftness of it all. It make it look so easy, and yet it is so difficult. But the more you get it, the easier it becomes, right? So the more you start getting truth, the easier the path becomes of clarification. It becomes easier and easier. So I can do that. Oh, I can do that. I can do that. And you get more and more used to it. But it's difficult to start out with. So just like for me, you say, how do I learn the ollie? Well, I tried it today and I got discouraged. I said, well, there's still, you know, I'm a complete moron. I can't do that. What do you? And I said, well, wait a minute. Let's at least figure out what I can do. So maybe I can leap up and learn to leap up and land on a skateboard. I don't have to flip it at first. Because obviously when you're leaping up with the ollie, you're coming down, you're going to land with your skateboard, you're going to land on the ground. So maybe I can just learn to land on the skateboard, and just this experience of you know, solidly landing on it, and not, you know, landing on the tail, or, you know, just learning how to center myself as far as jumping up and landing on it. And then you can learn to go back on the skateboard and pop, you know, kind of leaning back on it. But you have to lean, pop, and slide your front foot at the same, all kind of at the same time. It's sort of a synchronized, all in one motion thing that you have to do. Timing has to be very good on this. But, you know, the kids, once they get it, you know, they got it. It's like a kid, they can learn this. For older people, it's quite difficult, I would say. You know how kids, that once they get it, they try, they fall, then suddenly somehow they figure it out. The actions are so coordinated and quick. And then once they get it, boom, then they're off and running. Just listening to crickets. Nice evening tonight. Okay, now this is part of the video. It's like this just woke me up to something. Just wow. I didn't know this part of history. I didn't know what had happened. I didn't know what had happened. It was one guy that made it happen. Yeah, we know Tony Hawk, you know, helped make the vertical thing happen, make it really popular. But all the street skating, you know, I didn't know what, how did this happen? It's one guy that made it happen, actually. He really, really did. Just a total genius. The Course in Miracles is like a total genius, okay? A total genius book. Journey Beyond Words. Total genius. Total genius. If you study Journey Beyond Words, A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, if you really take it to heart and really absorb it, you're learning from genius. You're learning from spiritual genius. Just like watching, the kids watching Rodney Mullen do freestyle competition. I think he, out of like 35 contests he's entered in his life, he won 34 of them. He was a world champion at 14. 14. He hadn't been skating that long. He after a year, he started winning, you know, big championships. Just a year of skating. And then by the time he was just four, he started when he was 10, I think. 14, he won the world championship. Best skater in the world. 14 years old. And from then on, he was just unbeatable and continued to innovate and innovate and innovate. The greatest action sport athlete in history voted. And I don't know who would be better. I can't disagree with him at all. I mean, it just great, awesome athleticism, to say the least. Innovation, everything. If you saw him walking down the street, you wouldn't think twice. You wouldn't think anything about it, you know. it's just, you know, some people have this. So anyway, that's part of what has come to light. Second, was there another Facebook post by a friend on Facebook, which really also just knocked me out into a wow. Knocked me out. It was a story recounted by Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. Who really rewrote the book on miracles, if you want to know the truth. Her life was so miraculous that most people who think of miracles of Jesus, okay, Jesus, you know, turned the water into wine, did this and this, they think, okay, that's it. That's the best possible, right? But Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, her whole life was so miraculous that people just kind of just got used to, so this is just the way it happens. And I think most of us, most religious people, can't believe the stories at all. I absolutely do believe them. I've studied it intensely and in great depth, and the witnesses are so reliable and so diverse. And these accounts are written in the 20th century by very intelligent people. The sheer volume of it all makes it, you know, virtually impossible to refute. The number of disparate witnesses and how they witnessed and said, yes, indeed, I swear that this is what happened. I'm telling you the truth. I don't know how to explain it, but this is my experience, what happened. So there's this couple that had missed her darshan. They wanted to have her darshan, her viewing of her, and they were so sad. They were riding in a bus, and they're saying, "Ah, we missed her," and it's horrible, terrible. So they're riding along the countryside in this bus, and suddenly they look out their window, and walk along this dirt road way out in the boondocks, far away from where she was supposed to be, was Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. And they got to see her. And it's like, just, they were just wonderstruck. And later on, this story was recounted to the people at the ashram where she was, and they said, "What are you talking about? She was with us here the entire time. We had darshan of her the entire time." Now, this happened many, many, many times throughout her life. Many, many, many accounts where she was in one place and people swore that they were with her, a big group of people, and somebody at a distance, you know, far away, had this absolutely 100% clear meeting, encounter. She interacted with them in all sorts of ways, just like a, you know, a physical, real person here would be interacting. And at the same time, she was interacting with people in some other place, you know. It's called bilocation. It's called bilocation. She bilocated extensively, very extensively. And who knows, trilocation, quad location. She may have had a number of appearances going on at the same time. And people just got used to say, yeah, okay. It happens so often. All the stuff she did happened so often and so just matter-of-factly, the people in India are pretty used to a lot of this stuff. They just kind of, yeah, okay, this is great, but this is just what happens. This is how it works. But this isn't the amazing thing. I knew about this, but what was amazing was another account of her, some doctor or some very, very high professional and some devotee were together. Or some guru, some really very, very famous guru and her and a devotee. And this devotee wanted to learn some spiritual path or something like that and really asked for initiation into it and all this. And so they were with her in this room. And suddenly, as she was focusing on how to do this particular spiritual path, she suddenly, her entire body turned bright red. Everything turned red, including her hair, including her clothes. Everything about her was turned just this brilliant red. And then she'd been mantras and explanations and began pouring forth from her mouth. And she explained the entire thing perfectly about this path. Now, I read that and I said, oh my gosh. Because I had this amazing dream a while back, a couple months ago, of going up this staircase and then going through this very difficult fog and having faith. It was extremely difficult. I had to use tremendous faith to get through this fog. And I kept climbing. Finally, I got above all the cloudiness to this very high area, where I reached the top of this huge metal staircase that seemed to reach up into the sky. And I was greeted up there and congratulated like I had reached the top and was really something. And then somehow out of nowhere, I don't have no idea, this woman appeared. And she was dressed in this extremely bright red outfit. And then she began crying inconsolably. Nobody could calm her down. She was just weeping profusely. Now, when I woke from the dream, I realized this is a trademark of Sri Sri Nandamayama again, because she often would do that. When there was something very, very important to try to get your attention, it was extremely important. If you didn't do it, if you neglected it, she would start weeping. And her crying was legendary, that it literally was so severe that people, they just had to help her out. She was absolutely inconsolable. And they just, this, so this is something she was very much known for. Nobody had ever experienced anything like it. It was really, truly extraordinary. And so then the dream, this is exactly what happened. This woman who was dressed in this brilliant red color was kind of weeping inconsolably. I don't know where even she where she came from. It's like she just appeared there. She just appeared. She didn't come up the staircase. I mean, where did she come from? And so she just appeared. And so I didn't know what to do. And she kept weeping and weeping and weeping, and it was really causing such a commotion. I said, what do I do? And then I realized, well, I have to walk down the staircase. And I wonder if she wants to go down the staircase. Maybe she's nervous about this or something. So I said to her, I said, look, I'm going down the staircase. Do you want me to, you want to accompany me? Can I accompany you and help you go down the staircase? And she said, yeah, yeah. So I took her arm and we walked together down the staircase, back into the world, back into the world. The staircase going up took me out of the world, this very high spiritual place, and then walking back down took me back into the world. And so what she wanted was, she wanted somebody to accompany her in down into the world, someone to help her come into the world. And she just appeared where I was, and then was weeping so severely, I felt I had no choice but to offer her, to help her. I can't leave you here. So, you know, I said, well, I mean, you know, I offered to help, and then she accepted the help. And so when I heard this account of her turning red like that, I said, oh my gosh, because I suspected it was her. Vajrayogini, the queen of all Dakinis, all yoginis, queen of heaven, the queen of, you know, she's the highest of the highest is in Tibetan Buddhism. This reddish figure. But I suspected it was Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, but I wasn't sure. And she wanted me to help her come back into the world, which is very interesting, because this is how I have felt, something that I need to do to help her out, somehow help her. There's something she wants to do. She wants to help out the world in some way. So I said, wow, this is getting very interesting. Now, the correlation here is by taking A Course in Miracles, studying it, applying it, truly being absorbing it, what it has to say, and getting this very much flexibility of spiritual cross-training. Something like this doesn't bother me. Now, we know that Jesus Christ resurrected from the dead, and he met his apostles, etc. And so, we know that it is absolutely possible to resurrect from the dead. In fact, it's a piece of cake for the Dharma kings, really. Body's just an appearance of light. Just an appearance. They can have the body appear dead, they have the body appear alive, it's all the same to them. No difference at all. It's just an appearance, projected appearance. Mental projection. So, I also do that something about Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma that a lot of people don't know. This was an account that was given. And this happened on numerous occasions also. That when she was older, she lived to be 86 years old. When she was older, someone that was having darshan, there's a lot of people viewing her, and this man, suddenly, this old lady disappeared, and what wasn't there, and what he was seeing there was this young woman who, in perfect health, absolutely flawless health, not a spot of age upon her, actually. And he continued to see her this way, and continued, and all day and into the evening. And finally, at some point, you know, he it might have been the next day, he went to her and said, look, this I had this experience where, you know, this is what happened. And he explained to her, and she says, yes. He says, yes. She says, okay, let me explain to you what happened. She said, look, the way that this body is, she referred to herself as this body, the way I am is very, very different. And most people, they cannot accept the fullness of what is going on here. They have some preconceived notions, and they want things to go along a certain track, a certain way. We call it nature. They want things to follow natural cycles. She said, but this body here doesn't really know any of those cycles, is not subject to any of that, actually. However, they expect that this body is subject to nature. So she said, what my kaol, or what my inner grace is telling me, is to go along with it, play along with it, for their sake, so that they can keep coming to see you. She said, now look, if I remained perfectly free of all aging, and I'd be 80 years old or something, it would freak people out. They couldn't handle this. They say, wait a minute, you're supposed to be aging, you're not. It would scare them. It would really scare them. And she said, I just don't, it doesn't serve any purpose to scare them. She says, I don't care how my body looks. I'm here for the sake of the devotees. So most of them cannot handle the fact that my body really hasn't aged at all. He said, but you are able to. You're able to at least see that. And it doesn't bother you so much. That's why you're able to see. This is truly more like how I really am, as far as I don't feel any age or haven't really aged at all. I don't age. I'm not subject to nature. And he understood. He said, okay, yeah, I understand. So she appeared to grow older and to age, intentionally gave this appearance, allowed this appearance to people to see her that way because they wanted to. But it was in their own desire and mind. They didn't have to see her that way. Very interesting. It's like they were seeing a hallucination. So they were hallucinating that she was getting older because they all totally expected that is what takes place. And the hallucinations seem to be absolutely real. Absolutely real. Teeth are falling out. Hair is getting old. All this stuff. It's a mental image of some sort. And she allowed this, some role in allowing this to take place. Now, the same thing with the body dying. She had died many times before, actually. Dropped dead. Started rotting, dead. No pulse, no breath. But not just samadhi, but dead. Because that would happen when people rejected her purpose here and decided we don't want you to your purpose. We want you to change your purpose and do what we want you to do. And then she would drop dead. And then they'd get frantic and so frightened, and they'd say, okay, we'll do it your way. And then she would arise from the dead and return to, her youthful countenance like that. So when she died in 1982, her body dropped dead and appeared to be dead. But is she really dead? What is death to somebody that has repeatedly risen their body from the dead, returned a body that they're dead and returned it to life again? What is death for them, actually? It's just a game, isn't it? I mean, are they really dead? It's just like, is Jesus dead? I mean, he's in the tomb. Was he really dead? Or he said, no, just a game we're playing here. I'll raise the body up back to life, no problem. So is Sri Sri Anandamayi, is she really dead, is the question. Do gurus ever really die? Do gurus ever really die? So for me, with my advanced understanding that A Course in Miracles has given me, and A Journey Beyond Words, and advanced non-dual teachings, the answer is there's actually no such thing as death. No one's ever died. Nothing ever dies, actually. It's all just a mental projection. So someone who knows this and knows there's no need to die, no need for a body, no need to pretend to not be enlightened, they can have a body die, and then they can just have it not, and return to life. It's all the same to them. It's not a problem at all for them. And this doesn't bother me at all. I could see how this works. Not everything about it, but enough about it just to say, of course. Of course you have power over nature. Nature has no power over spirit at all. None. Zero. And theologically, it doesn't cause any conflict in my mind at all. Whereas an egotistical mind, ego mind of believing the ego's God, this would cause the most consternation and trouble. They can't handle it at all. And for me, it's I don't feel any problem. It's just like the skateboarders. They see a staircase, a handrail, a picnic table. There's no problem at all for them. Oh, let's just jump up on it, slide and jump off, and it's not a problem for them. But to the rest of us, we say that's just like virtually impossible what you're doing. What are you doing? You're going to kill yourself, you know. We look at these skaters and say they're going to kill it. But no, they land it, you know. It's just, you know, occasionally they take some tumbles. But the good ones, I mean, they just know what they're doing. It's so amazing. The accurate lines they take, you know, and the timing and everything. They're just really talented. But so for them, it's not difficult. So, Jesus coming back from the dead, yeah. For Jesus, that's a piece of cake, actually. And we could easily do it, too, if we stopped believing that the body was necessary in the first place. Stop believing that nature was necessary in the first place, which it isn't. It's just how we pretend to not be enlightened. Every one of us is already enlightened, but we're pretending to not be enlightened. That's all. That's all that nature, all this body's, all it is we're pretending, insisting that we're not enlightened. We have to seek enlightenment. We have to, you know, advance towards enlightenment. That's all absolute nonsense. Every single one of us is already enlightened. And if you want to put it in conceptual time-based terms, the Holy Spirit has enlightened all of us. The truth is, we never have not been enlightened. We never fell from grace at all. It's impossible, for how could we fall from grace, the perfect Son of God? It's impossible. But we want to honor our creativity, so we make it seem like we did. And that's why the Holy Spirit now helps us make it seem like we didn't. We want to honor our creativity and believing that, yeah, you know, we did fall from grace. But we didn't. No one has fallen from grace. We've never not been enlightened. No one has never been not enlightened. This is the truth. So these bodies are pretending that there's some aspect of something about us that's not enlightened. That's all they are. This world, bodies, everything that's happening here is just our make-believe that there's some, in some way, we're not already enlightened. That's all it is. So like these skateboarders, they do these tricks. They say, oh yeah, do that. It's like this. You just go jump up, flip, flip, flip. Yeah, it's simple, right? Yeah, just like this. And that's all there is to it. And we're like, huh? I have no idea. I mean, you even have these skateboarders and they're watching Rodney Mullen. And their comments are like, what did he do? What was that? They can't even figure it out. They don't even know. Just like, what? But for him, it's like, oh yeah, I'm just doing this. And it's just like that. You know, it's, like, it's not difficult. So it's like, once you get it, you know, it's not difficult. So again, these bodies that we think we are, no, those are just excuses. We're saying this represents, you know, the unenlightened aspect of ourselves. We don't have an unenlightened aspect of ourselves. Not at all. So it's all just complete make-believe. Total make-believe. And again, I understand this might be very difficult, but for me, it's been entirely simple and easy. But if you try to teach somebody an ollie, you know, that's not practicing it, it's, you're not going to get very far. You really have to kind of, I mean, how the kids learn it is quite something. They just try it. You know, they see someone else do it. They say, oh, okay. And they say, okay, and they start working on it and fall and fall and fall and fail, fail, fail. But the kids, they don't give up. The next day, they try and try and try it again. You know, they don't stop until they get it because they want to be with their other friends who are doing it. And they see all this wonderful, fun stuff that their friends are doing. And they say, man, I want to do that too. I'm not going to quit. I'm going to get this. So they're really committed and they work at it and they get it. It's pretty astonishing. Same thing with spiritual path is we want to get it. And so we have to just keep working at it very determinedly and say that, you know, failure is not even an option. It's not even in my mind. If failure was never in my mind. It's never been in my mind. Just, you know, I'm gonna get this and that, and you know, just keep working at it until I get it. But I'm gonna get it for sure. So asking questions is pretty foolish, and giving explanations is pretty foolish. And how you doing, Ollie? There's a few things you, but just somehow, you just have to say, you know, one way or the other, I am going to get that somehow. And so, you know, you can, what can I do? So, well, for sure, you got to be able to leap, and you have to have good balance, and you have to be able to land, and then you start out. Get that down. Get that. Do what you can do. Do what you can do. And then you just have faith that at some point it's going to click for you, that somehow you're going to start getting off the ground a little bit. Even if it's like a couple inches or something. But you will get off the ground at some point. You just have to believe, because so many have done it. So they'll tell you, yeah, it takes a lot of work and it's not easy, but you start getting off the ground a little bit, and then once you start getting it, you'll start getting off the ground more and more. Say, okay, you need to trust them. Say, okay, that's how it goes. Okay, now the third part. Today's August 29th. It's a very important day. The next day is what, September 6th, or late after Labor Day. Labor Day's coming up. I believe it's this coming Monday or something. Today's the 29th, and Tuesday's the 30th, Wednesday's the 31st, Friday, Thursday's the 1st, Friday's the 2nd, Saturday's the 3rd, Sunday's the 4th. Labor Day's probably Monday the 5th, and so the 6th is the day after Labor Day. This is also a very significant date. So like a week from today, it's very significant. Very spiritually significant, what's going on. Now, all this is arising right now in for me. Now, I've been tipped off for a long time, 20 years, that Sri Sri Anandamayi is going to do something to help us out. Coming up here, I knew in the future at some point she was going to do something to help us out. She's not done with her helping out. That was just the first course of the meal, you know, in the 20th century. She has more juice, that is for sure. She's got more help is on the way. She made it very clear, more help's on the way. Very helpful, very helpful. Now, there was another incident in her life, and I've recounted this before, the Kali worshippers of the Kali Temple in Ramna Park in Dhaka, where she had an ashram there, where she started out, and she told all of them, she tried to relocate them to India. Some of them refused. They say, we're old school, we don't want to change or innovate, no, we just want to keep sticking with what we've done, and we don't want to, you know. And she said, well, you know, okay, I'll do everything I can to try to relocate you, but if you stay here, you know, it's you may meet you know, meet your end in this way. And she, you know, and they said, no, we don't care. If that's what happens, that's what happens. So she warned them. They didn't listen, and they were massacred. So we have a lot of religious people in the world, a lot of Christians who, many of us have been telling them, look, you know, let's get into this better understanding. It's very important to get us to understand, because we're going to need help coming up. A lot of help. And you know, a lot of them are saying, no, we're just going to stick with what we know, and if things go bad for us, you know, they go bad for us. Well, this is very, very reminiscent of what happened with Sri Sri Anandamayi. She tried to help them. They didn't follow her advice, didn't take her help. They were, you know, might say they were lazy or whatever, too hidebound, and you know, trouble found them. It's very similar to what's going on right now in the world. Is the help is available. Is available. The Dharmakink help's available. It will be even more available very soon. It could be significantly available, actually. And we have to be able to understand what's going on. and flow with it and move with it and not feel and stay stable, like land on our board, land on our skateboard. We're like jumping up in the air. We got to land on our skateboard. We got to land the trick. We got to get airborne and then land it. So we have to be talented, spiritually talented to do this. And so many in the world just say, no, we're just going to continue on with whatever was in the past, and that's it. Well, trouble's likely to find them. It really is. What can you do? Okay, now, I'm concerned. I'm very jittery, and I get this way before there's some sort of crisis. There's been a number of crises, hasn't there been, in the world? 9/11 was one of them, wasn't it? Changed everything radically. And I was very nervous before that happened. Very, very nervous indeed. Of course, I was spiritually tipped off to it all a couple years in advance. And then when it got real close to it, I started feeling very jittery and nervous. It was terrible. And same thing with like tsunamis and various major crises. I get jittery and nervous as it gets closer. So we're getting close to something. We're also getting close to getting greater help from the Dharma kings, from the great protectors of spiritual truth. Because they're going to help out. What is going to come in this world is going to be so troublesome, psychologically, spiritually troublesome to us, that the grace of God is going to act in a very strong way. And we have to be ready for that. And this includes the Dharma kings actually appearing here in the flesh. Appearing here. And Jesus will simply appear here. And Jesus is here in the flesh, for example. Sri Sri Mahanamaha may very well appear here in the world. In the flesh. Just appear. Now, I'm all for this. I have no problem at all. I mean, that's how they should. That's what they should do, is just appear. They don't have to be born. What kind of nonsense is that? They could just mentally project a body and there they are. No trouble at all for them. They don't need any past. They don't need any mother, any father, any family, all this stuff. Not at all. They can relate to us directly as friends. Not any problem at all for them. And it shouldn't be a problem for us either. So we may very well be entering the age of these Dharma kings simply appearing in the world. And are you ready for that? I certainly am ready for that. Certainly am ready for that. And I'm ramping up my focus, etc. for this. But I understand that some, it just like, for instance, devotees on my mind, they may not be able to handle that. So you're not going to try to shove it down their throats so much, and you know, not going to be taking pictures if it happens, and just let it happen organically. Let people get used to it. It'd be quite a shock. I mean, they, you know, most people think that the Dharma kings are dead and buried, and they're in the ground, they're in the tomb. What do you mean she appeared here, especially like appearing in America? I said, what? No, she belongs to us. She can't just appear in America right now. You don't want to give pictures and stuff, because that'll like prove it's true. That's like, will just be too much for them. So it's better that they just disregard it, or say, no, that didn't happen, or you're just making this up, or whatever. They're lovely people. Why you know, cause them undue consternation? So I'm okay with that. It has to be sort of, we have to ease into whatever happens. So something is likely, something is coming up. And I believe it has something to do with the American politics, and something in American politics, which really has the world's attention right now, doesn't it? The priest even mentioned it this Sunday. And I love the priests. They're wonderful. They do a great job. The theology of the Catholic Church, there's a lot of stuff which is very much ego-based. But, I mean, the priests, you know, a lot of them have their own insights into God and Spirit, which are better than the fundamental, you know, dogmatic teachings of the Church, which are more advanced, actually. And they let you know that this is how they see it. So, yeah. I have a lot of love and respect for priests and pastors and rabbis and all that. Yeah, they often have somewhat of a more advanced perspective than the institution itself. Okay, that's a good way of putting it. So he's talking about the election. He's saying, wow, this is getting really, really terrible. Yeah. It's what is being brought to light is this enormous, like almost like civil war in America, actually, an ideological civil war. And it's getting real, real nasty and dangerous. I know, I'm aware of I'm just psychically aware, intuitively aware of how bad it's been for a long time. And you know, one side wants to crush the other side doesn't want to be crushed. The liberals want to crush conservative culture. They want to destroy it. They want to destroy traditional values, for sure. They want them wiped out off the face of the earth, and the conservatives don't want that to happen. Okay, so it's a very, very, very toxic situation in the United States. And it's this kind of situation, when it's this bad, you have to realize, when it's this serious, when we're talking about extermination, annihilation of a culture, conservative culture, and taking away their guns, for instance, to protect their culture. Excuse me. Smoothie. This smoothie is watermelon, banana, pineapple, and papaya. That's my dinner. Okay, that's my dinner. That's what was available. I said, let me make a smoothie. So I'm into it. It's the 29th and I gotta recommit. I'm trying to recommit to do, you know, going forward of learning how to do an Ollie and continuing with a lot of fruit smoothies. And I've got to start redisciplining myself. I'm eating too many peanuts and chocolate right now. So back to the basics. Let's get back to the basics. Very important. Because we're facing a political crisis in the United States. And the threat that both sides feel very threatened by the other side, extremely threatened. Because the liberals feel that conservatives are trying to reimpose their social, their values, their traditional values on society. And the whole point of liberalism is to get rid of those values. So they feel that their culture is threatened. Their whole point of being a liberal is to get rid of these traditional values. But they think these traditional values are the cause of all the world's problems. And so they feel they're saving Mother Earth by getting rid of these values. Whereas the conservatives feel exactly the opposite. They feel the liberal values are destroying the planet. And by maintaining their conservative values, they're saving the planet. So both sides think they're saving humanity and the planet. And the other side's destroying it. It's that polarized here. That's that severe, folks. It is extremely severe. So, in such a situation, if you have historical wisdom, you know that's a dangerous situation. And things don't always go well in under those circumstances. So, under those circumstances that we have here, where each side feels that their whole purpose for existence is about to be wiped out, you know, they may take some action into their own hands. Okay, that is possible. This has happened throughout history. You have to understand this, that these political candidates are not invulnerable, you know, they're not God. They're not Jesus. And so they are vulnerable, and that can be you know, exploited by the other side. Physical vulnerability that can come into play. It can come into play. So there's a strong possibility of this coming into play. The exploitation of the physical vulnerability of the candidates, strong probability it can come into play right now, actually. It God forbid that it does, but we certainly all pray that it doesn't. But what we say, hope for the best and prepare for the worst. Under these circumstances, look, President Kennedy in Dallas, they warned him, don't go to Texas. There's very dangerous. There's so much hostility there. It's a bad, bad, bad thing. You know, don't do it. Political climate, all right? People feeling threatened, etc. like that. When people feel really threatened, they try to defend what they, you know, they try to take action. So, we've been through that. I certainly went through that. I think 1963 was. And that was the end of the innocence of the United States. And I radically changed my life, that is for sure, because all the adults, everybody's freaking out, and I didn't understand. This is horrible. Scared me to death. As I'm here, as I was, you know, maybe at that age, may have been skateboarding by then, and just living this wonderful California life, and then suddenly all the adults and everybody was just sobbing and crying and drastically shaken up. Everybody is just like, everybody's suddenly freaked out. I'm just like a kid, just saying, what? They say, well, you're the president. He's just been shot. He died. I said, what are you talking about? To me, it's like, I didn't understand really what the total importance of it was or anything, but for them, it was like their culture had just died. Camelot had just died. And they just never recovered, really. They never recovered. And they thought Bobby Kennedy's going to save it and bring it back, and look what happened to him. Same thing. And when you're all the adults in your life, when you're a kid, suddenly change and go into this funk, you know what? It affects you severely. And it severely affected me. There's no question that I started a tailspin at that time. I started, like I said, I've got to bring happiness back to everybody, all the adults, because they suddenly lost their confidence. They all lost their confidence. Before then, they were so confident. My parents were so confident. They said America's the greatest place in the world. We're the greatest people in the world. We can't lose. We can't miss. We're going to have this fantastic life here. We're just going to, you know, make paradise here on the earth. And then suddenly, they lose their leader. They lose their confidence. And now they're brooding, and now they're shaken to the core. It shook them to the core. Shook their confidence to the core. And then, of course, then I said, oh my God, I got to help bring it back. So what can I do? What can I do? So that really maybe was the start of my intense spiritual path when I was about 7 years old, actually. Is what can I do to bring back this confidence and this feeling that people have confidence in themselves? And it's been a difficult task, hasn't it? Wow. Don't place your faith in political leaders, for one thing. Put your faith in someone who's resurrected themselves from the dead. Okay, this is my advice. Jesus Christ certainly resurrected from the dead. Sri Sri Nanda Ma certainly resurrected from the dead on a number of occasions. Ah, my eyes are burning. I think maybe from the sweat or some salt in my eyes. Wow. Place your faith in those who have resurrected from the dead. Longchenpa has certainly shown that he is very much alive. Ramaharshi showed me he's very much alive. Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodo showed me very, very much alive. Padmasambhava showed me he's very much alive. So there's these various wonderful friends we have that have shown that the death has not buried them at all. In fact, it hasn't touched them. Put your faith in them, and don't put your faith in political candidates. So I've been preaching this to everyone, but no, very few are listening, actually. They think they know better. I say, don't put your faith in political candidates. This is one of the main messages on YouTube that I've been preaching. Put your faith in Jesus Christ. Put your faith in the Dharma Kings. Put your faith in the Holy Spirit. Above all else, the Holy Spirit cannot die. It's formless. Put your faith in that which cannot die, or that which death cannot touch, who've proven this. And forget about putting your faith in political candidates, because you know what? They're not invulnerable. they believe that bodies are necessary, this world is necessary, and therefore they believe they're bound by the dynamics of nature, which means life and death. So they believe they're bound to life and death. That means they believe they're vulnerable to death. Whereas a Dharma king realizes that they're not vulnerable to death at all. It's just a dream. How vulnerable is a dreamer to a dream? Not at all. But those who believe the body's necessary, pretending that we're not enlightened is necessary to pretend. We have to, if we believe we're not enlightened, we got to pretend to not be enlightened. So the body is necessary for that. It's a great way of pretending we're not enlightened, isn't it? And when you believe that illusion's real, you then are bound to believe that the dynamics of this illusion are affecting you. So you think, oh yeah, the body's subject to dying, and so the body will seem to be subject to death. Doesn't have to be, but if we take illusions to be true, it certainly, then we have no choice but to seem to suffer from the limitations that we are believing in. If we believe that we're limited, then we suffer from the belief in those limitations. So certainly political candidates are subject to death, untimely deaths. They certainly are. So don't put your faith in them. Don't put your faith in them. So too many people in this world are putting their faith. They think the world is in peril, and that this political election here in the United States is the key election to determine whether the world is saved or not. Whether in all this climate change stuff that they've been preaching for so long now, that they've really backed themselves into a corner. And they really feel, like for instance, liberals really feel the conservatives gain power, the world is literally going to die and everyone on it is going to die. They really believe this. So for them, it's not only their life and death, it's the life and death of their children, their grandchildren, their great-grandchildren. It's the life and death of all humanity is at stake. And if the conservatives regain power, they really believe that the entire planet, ecosystem, everything is going to collapse and we'll all die. Everything on the planet is going to die. They basically, maybe, I don't know, maybe ants might make it through, I don't know. But This is literally what many of them believe in, and believe in very, very, very strongly. There's no two ways about it in their mind. Now, the conservative values believe that if the liberals gain the upper hand and control, that we will all die spiritually, because they're destroying spiritual values, and we'll all then go to hell spiritually. We'll fail to, get to heaven in a drastic way. And this spiritual failure is way worse than any physical failure it could possibly be. This is what they honestly believe, and they really believe in this. We'll all go to hell and maybe be spiritually annihilated. Now, I got to tell you, neither one of those sides is right at all. That neither one is right, but they truly have the conviction and belief in this, and they cannot see past it. So under those circumstances, both sides are liable to want to take drastic action against the other side. Drastic action, whatever means, the ends justify the means in their minds. So we're in a very, very dangerous time politically in the world for those who put their faith in politics and political solutions. A very dangerous time, to say the least. Nothing would be surprising. Nothing that happens would be surprising. In the song that I composed, Running Out of Time, I say, don't bother me with political solutions. What we need is a heavenly infusion. Don't bother me with political solutions. What we need is a heavenly infusion. This, I wrote the song back in 1997, 98. Because I knew what was coming. So, about 18 years ago. And I said, don't seek for answers, political answers. That is not going to work. What we need is a heavenly infusion, which means what we need is the return of the Dharma kings to return to the world, physically be here, appear here. That's what we really need. Start being friends, start getting acquainted with the Dharma kings and realize, hey, those who are beyond death are our friends, and they're friending us, and they're telling us, yeah, you can do this too. Stop identifying with political figures. They don't have the answer. They don't have the answer for the destiny of this world at all, actually. So that's what I'm all about. Yeah. This is not difficult for me at this point. It would be. I'd welcome it. I'd say, finally, you know, it's about time. You know, we've been waiting for a heavenly infusion here. Come on. This is what we need. We don't need politics, more politics. No, we don't. Now, there are many, many signs, indications, dreams, trends, everything pointing that a crisis is coming and the Dharma Kings will appear here in some way. They're going to help us out big time to get through this crisis. Because I can tell you that the shock of one of these political parties suddenly losing their political candidate, the shock of that will devastate them mentally, devastate them. They have their heroes, they have their leaders, and they think the fate of the world depends upon it. To lose their leader at this point would be just mentally devastating. And the devastation would result in tremendous physical fatigue, apathy, going into the despair, going into depression, going into mental illness. It's that strong of a thing, because they believe that the fate of the world hangs on this election, and that they are the ones who are going to save the world. And suddenly they feel that they've lost that chance. It's slipped away from them. It's gone. Then they feel like they have no purpose in life. That, you know, and this is devastating. This is terrible. And you'd be amazed at how fatigued and tired your body becomes when you're in this mental condition. You become very vulnerable to sicknesses, illnesses, all types of sicknesses and illnesses, all sorts of substance abuses, self-medications, addictions. You become vulnerable to accidents. You lose your strength. It's like when an old person falls, it shocks them so badly that they become very weak. It takes them a long time to recover just psychologically. The body just feels exhausted. I've been practicing falling because I want to highlight all of this to you. That when you fall down, and I've been doing it repeatedly. Like I fell 20 times yesterday. I'm actually demonstrating to people how to fall. So I've been falling on carpets, on all over the place to show people this is how you fall. Well, this makes you feel really tired. I wonder, why do I feel so tired, so exhausted? Well, psychologically, when you fall, you're thinking you're not supposed to fall. You take great pride in never falling. So when you fall, this is a blow to your psyche. Excuse me. I think this fruit smoothie is doing something to me. Excuse me. It's a blow to your psyche. It's a very strong blow to your psyche. So I'm doing it 20 times in a day. As I say, the more you do it, the less blow of a psyche you get used to. It doesn't cause any problem at all. But initially, it's a shock. Even when you know you're doing it on purpose, it's a big, big shock. So I realize how important this Holy Spirit told me. You got to start tumbling and falling and get more and more used to it. Because there is going to be a tumble and a fall taking place in our culture and our society in some way. One way or the other. You know, let's say nothing happens to either candidate and the election takes place. That, it too, is going to be a drastic shock to the other side. Drastic shock. They feel that the world's going to come to an end. No matter who wins, half the people in America feel that the world's going to come to an end. That's not a good thing, right? There are a number of scenarios. Whatever scenario plays out, it's going to be drastically shocking to us. Like a severe fall. And a great number of people are going to psychologically go downhill. This is what's going to happen. There's no way around it. So we have to treat the trouble. We have to take proactive steps to treat it. When you see something that's guaranteed to happen, you have to be proactive. You can't just sit by and hope that it doesn't happen. There's no scenario that could happen politically in the United States that is going to prevent a huge number of people from feeling they've lost their purpose in life and from going downhill very badly, mentally, very badly. So seeing that, we have to be proactive. And we have to introduce some catalytic agent that helps flip the script for them. So they put the brakes on their skid. Put the brakes on their skid. And it doesn't matter what side goes downhill. The bottom line is they're on a skid towards mental illness, and that's got to be stopped. Has to be stopped. I'm impartial in this. Really, have to be impartial. What I'm all about is helping sidestep mental illness, severe mental illness. Try to sidestep the worst of it for everybody. I don't care who it is, because we're all already enlightened, right? We're just pretending not to be, and yet in our pretense, we're taking it very seriously. And so, if we think the means to become enlightened are suddenly taken away from us, this is drastic problem mentally for us, and we can get into this very, very severe mental problems. The gurus know this. They certainly know this. Yeah, it's all pretense, but when we forget that it's pretense and we take it totally seriously, then we can pretend to be very, very messed up. Yes, we can. And when we think the road to happiness, to enlightenment, is ruined for us, this is a drastic problem. But of course, like in my case, and it's not so bad, because I know I'm already enlightened. Everyone is. Not just me, everyone is. So there's they can't lose. They can't miss. Nobody can miss. There's no need for any search. There's no need for any path. There's no need for any world, even. If the world's going to be ruined, well, so what? We're already enlightened. We don't even need a world. Nobody needs a world, actually. So it doesn't bother me the way it would bother those who think they need to become enlightened. For me, there's no becoming at all. At least I'm comfortable with this. Longchenpa, I'm very comfortable. He says, there's no becoming. The non-dual is there's no becoming at all. We're already that which we're searching for. So it doesn't matter who's in charge or what the future. None of that matters. It's all pretense. It's all pretense. It doesn't. But if you're not comfortable with this, it's a different story. It's a different story. And I know that people's troubles affect me, because I want them to be happy. So many people are maybe sliding down into drastic mental illness. I'm not happy about that at all. I want to help, just like when I was a kid. I wanted to help my parents and the adults in the world. I said they're so unhappy now. They're so shocked. They're on this bummer. I want to help them. So let me sing a song. Let me do a dance. Let me try to, you know. But nothing helped. Nothing worked. Nothing worked. And I felt like a failure. You know, severe failure. I wanted to compose some beautiful music to make them feel better, but they were in this funk. Nothing could take them out of this funk. And then, you know, the 60s, the roaring 60s, the hippie 60s got going, and people turned to sex, drugs, and rock and roll to try to get out of this funk. But that ultimately has just led them into this more precarious situation that we're in now. We're in a very precarious situation in the world, which is why I feel so jittery. Again, no scenario do I see that is not precarious, other than truly heavenly infusion. Very proactive move we need to take to get some divinity, some Dharma kings here, and get them, start getting used to them. This is the only remedy I see right now at this point. We have to just start getting used to them. It's like watching Rodney Mullen free skate. Like when you're a kid in Florida or something, you go to this contest, and there's this kid comes out, and he just like blows everybody's mind and says, this is just the most amazing thing I've ever seen. You know, you have to start getting used to that. All right, there's no other way around it. And you know what they did? They did get used to it. They said, well, let me start trying this. And they, you know, they couldn't do what he did, but they could start, you know, doing some of the stuff. And nobody's really ever gotten as good as he was. But there's some who've do some amazing, amazing stuff, but they're not quite as good as him, you could say. But still, they're really outstanding. So there's been quite a few outstanding skaters, and a lot of very good ones come along, because they picked up on it and said, oh, wow, this is extraordinary. So we need an appearance of like a Rodney Mullen Mullinesque appearance of the Dharma kings need to spiritually, someone comes in spiritually, just says, hey, look at me, I'm doing this stuff. And we're just like, wow, that's amazing. And then we need to just like get used to it and say, okay, let's start working on this. Let's start working on our ollies. That's what the kids did. They started working on their ollies and their half flips and whatever it is, push shoves or I don't know, shoved to something, and they got all these names for stuff. I don't know what they're doing. I haven't really figured it out yet. Somehow they use their foot and they shove their board. They spin it around an axis. They're so good at spinning their board around an axis. They're somehow aware of that. I never was aware of that. That the board can somehow, you can spin it around an axis accurately and time that spin somehow and jump and spin and land on the board. Wow. But that's why they made these symmetrical boards. Now, my longboard, this board is not symmetrical. But they made these symmetrical boards so that they could spin it around the axis. I didn't understand that. I may need to get another. I have a board without the trucks. I don't have a complete set. I just have the board, the platform, whatever they call it. Maybe I need to get a symmetrical board if I want to start spinning around an axis. To do these tricks, you really have to find that, the easily have this balanced axis to spin it and flip it and do all this stuff. I didn't understand that, but I didn't want to do these tricks. I'll have to do something. Maybe get some trucks and wheels for this board I have, and which is balanced, and see how that goes. At some point, I may do that. So this is where we're at right now. We're at a time that is so precarious, that is literally going toward almost guaranteed drastic mental problems for the world. Because once, it doesn't matter which side's in charge, a lot of people in the world are going to feel that's the end of the world for them. Man, I can easily understand this too. I mean, if I take the, I'm able to take both put myself in the shoes of both liberals and conservatives. I really am able to do that. And if I put myself in their shoes, like if I put myself in conservative shoes, there's no question at all. If the liberals gain power in this election in the United States, the conservatives are going to be destroyed. No doubt about it. They'll lose the guns will be taken away from them. They'll have no way to protect themselves. The laws will be changed such a way. Their values will be exterminated. They'll be exterminated as a culture. They will be. Yeah, I totally understand how they feel that way. And then if you switch over, put my shoes, liberal shoes on, and look and see if the conservatives regain power, it's from a liberal standpoint, they feel that the world is going to be ruined, destroyed. That they'll never, it won't be able to stop. It's already, they say, it's already so bad that it's like maybe too late. Their favorite thing is to say, well, it's too late already. Well, if it's too late already, then who cares? But too late already, but, they say, there's, we at least have to try our best. So we have to be, the liberals feel, we have to just pass every law possible to try and save the earth. And we just have to crush anything that could possibly be harming, harming Mother Earth, or and on and on and on. It's tied together to environmentalism. So from their standpoint, the Earth is going to die if the conservatives win. The Earth is going to die, and we'll die with it. And it's just this. So that's how bad it is for them. And they've painted a picture of the conservatives. These are the arch enemies of the Earth. They destroy it. This is what they do. They don't care about it. Now, this isn't true, but this is what they believe. They really believe this. They've kind of made a boogeyman out of it all, such a severe boogeyman that they can't get past that at all. So from their standpoint, it's a disaster. It would be an absolute disaster of the highest magnitude. They've really wrapped themselves up in this belief system. I've seen it happen. I told them, don't do it. You really, really, really are going to have troubles if you do that. But they did it. It's all climate change, could destroy everything. The Caserta are just, all they do is just completely destroy the earth, and they have no values at all worth saving, and they must be defeated, and on and on and on and on. The boogeyman, the Koch brothers, they're all Caserta, it's the Koch brothers, that's, they're all like that, And they just make this straw man of just like this disaster there, and climate change is going to destroy everything that's already proven. It's going to destroy, and they just insist upon this doomsday mentality they have. Liberals have this extreme doomsday mentality that if things don't go their way, it's it. We're all doomed, completely doomed. Whereas conservatives are not so much that way. They say, the earth's going to be okay. I know there's some issues and we'll work on it, but it's very resilient. And traditional values work, and we believe and trust in God, and God's will work out here, and we're not, so freaked out about doomsday like that. So anyway, you have this extreme divide, and it's not healable based on the amount of effort that's been put in to creating this doomsday scenario, and the animosities this creates. It's been a polarization, but it's intentional. It's been intentional. I've seen it. Didn't have to go that way at all. This is what happened. This is what's taken place. Ship has already sailed. Water's already gone under that bridge. The barnyard animals have already escaped. What good is it shutting the door? It's happened. So there's no reasoning. You cannot step in the middle of this dogfight and reason with anyone. It's not possible. So that door's closed. There's no way. Political solution is not going to work. We need a heavenly infusion. We need some spiritual presences that are so wonderful and profound that people just say, "Ah, heck with politics. This is way more interesting." Maybe God is helping us out, and we need to go in that route some way. But the religious conservatives, they say, "No. God only helps out in this way. That's it. You have to do it this way, and if it doesn't happen this way, it's no good. It's the devil." They're stuck in this old-fashioned, belief system that isn't true. So it's very hard to help them out because they insist that God's grace can only work in the way that they say it can work, like they're in control of it. And they know everything there is to know about God's grace, which they don't. They do not. The Christians don't know everything about God's grace, not by a long shot. They don't know how God's grace works through Vajrayana Buddhism, for instance, through Indian gurus, for instance. There's a lot that they don't know about God's grace, how God's grace works. God's grace works in a 360-degree way in many, 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 many ways, actually. But they think, no, only through Jesus, that's the only way, and only through the way the church describes it, Jesus, and only in this, and they just narrow it down to a ridiculousness. So they've made this boogeyman of anything outside of their narrow definition of God's grace. And it's absurd. The narrowness is just absurd. I don't have this narrowness. I'm wide open to God's grace. God's grace can work in every which way. It's not limited. But they've been convinced that to be good citizens, they have to believe in this control system that was brought about ultimately in Christianity of no, there's only one Jesus, and that what makes it nice and orderly, right? Because again, the Roman Empire, there was all these different churches that arose throughout their empire, Christian churches, and they were rioting and arguing and civil unrest and everything, and then the Roman emperors, they said, "Hey, this is terrible. I mean, we need just one figurehead, like an emperor, one creed, one figurehead, and that's it, or we're going to exterminate you." So they said, "Wow, okay, Jesus is it. There could never be another Jesus. That never will be another Jesus. This is our creed. This is So it makes people pacifies, right? The empire is. They said, "Well, Jesus could never happen again. Okay, it's already happened. There's no other figure that can ever bring truth to us, and we've got the creed already. So if there's nobody else can come along and give a different creed, right? So there can never be any factionalism taking place. That's what they wanted. They wanted social stability. So they say, no, nobody could ever be like Jesus. Whereas Jesus said, you'll all be like me. Greater things than this you shall all do, you know? He didn't say, I'm the only one who's going to work all these miracles and know truth and know God and know the grace of God. He gave us the Holy Spirit. He said, the Holy Spirit will explain everything to you clearly, just as clear as I know it. So this whole idea of this narrow definition of God's grace, only in with Jesus, there's nothing else outside of that. And only in this very narrow definition of Jesus, in this dualistic nature of Jesus, divine and human, which is absolutely untrue. That's it. You know, they said nothing, everything else is the devil, they think. So this puts them, backs them, they back themselves into a corner very badly too. So both sides are very badly backed into a corner. Very badly backed into a corner. I haven't been able to break through at all. I've made massive efforts, and you know, it just hasn't gotten in anywhere. There's just a few wonderful spirits here that get it, you know. They have the flexibility of mind to feel it. But there, I'm sure they're feeling like, wow, what can I do to help out? Well, we're bound to get some help. We're bound to get some help. We don't have to carry the whole load going forward. The load's going to be too heavy for us. Just like it was when I was 7 years old and President Kennedy was assassinated. And all the adults freaked out. It was too heavy a load for me. I couldn't handle the load. It collapsed me. I felt so guilty. You know, I'm so inadequate. It was terrible. So inadequate. The adults, they've lost their edge, you know, they've lost their confidence, and Humpty Dumpty fell off a wall. I can't put Humpty Dumpty back together again. It felt so inadequate. It was so terrible. Well, imagine the feeling going forward in this world now. Just imagine the children, the young people, how they're going to feel. But society in general is, you know, Humpty Dumpty's fallen. We can't get it back. It's finished. Doom. So we really need something that just flips the script. A real Rodney Mullen skateboard flipping moment. That we just say, what in the world was that? I don't get it how he did that, but I love what he did. I'm watching the video and Rodney Mullen, I don't have a clue what he's doing. And I don't think most people do. It's just so fast and so smooth and so, what? What happened? I don't know. But he just flowed right through it. And so it's like, yeah, this is great. I don't know how he does it, but he does it. And eventually we'll figure out how he does it. I'm starting to dig into it a little bit. I'm having a lot of trouble. The terminology in street skating, I don't understand it very well at all. I don't understand front side and back side. It's like opposite of what I would think. Going the side that's towards the turn is the back side? What? Should be the front side. I don't know. So the way they talk about everything, it's such a slang and a lingo and all this stuff to its own. And they explain it, you know, a Prebo to a Casper to a Manual to what? What are they talking about? I got to figure that out. I've got to dig into it and find out what a Manual is and Primo, you know, side. It's not easy. They don't explain it very, very well, actually. I have to keep digging into it here. It's a world unto itself. All these different shoves they're talking about. What shove? Okay. Saran wrap. Wow. They do just some just really amazing balancing things. It's just as they're moving like this, the coordination they have is just virtue almost beyond belief, actually. But they're so committed, you know, that's important commitment. They do it. So we don't have to understand how it works to appreciate it. We don't have to understand how the Dharma Kings, how the miracles are happening, everything. We just appreciate it. They say, wow, look at the way they're flowing and what they're doing. It's just like, wow, that's amazing. But we feel like, well, you know, let's see if we can at least, you know, do an ollie here and do maybe we can learn a couple tricks, right? Yeah, probably we can. The easier ones we probably can, and maybe we might even learn a more difficult one down the road, or a few, right? And maybe some of us will learn a lot of them. I don't know, but at least we could say, yeah, I can accept this. It's that You know, because we watch Rodney Mullins skating, and we say, well, you know, I could accept it. The guy's a genius at what he's doing, but he's doing it. Instead of just saying, I don't want to see that, you know. You know, it's a testimony to my fitness that I'm able to accept it. I guess before I just didn't want to look at it. I said, I don't want to know about it. It's too much for me. It's too humiliating or something. I don't know. But now I'm in good enough shape. I said, well, you know, yeah, it's pretty amazing. But maybe I could like do some of it. It's possible. So I'm open to it now. My mind open to it. Before, my mind was closed to it. It's open to it now. And that promoting skate culture, obviously, I mean, it is what it is. It's pretty raw. It's pretty grungy. It's pretty tough. It's you know, it is what it is. These people are daredevils, to say the least. Very committed, very intense daredevils, and what they're doing is, you know, is quite dangerous. And so they have this sort of bravado. You know, it's very intense bravado, very tough, intense, raw bravado in the skate culture. Yeah, you know, a lot of motifs, skull and crossbones and stuff, you know, that they just kind of say, like, you know, skate or die. You know, I mean, it's like what we're doing, you know, it's like do or die sort of stuff. So you understand, there's a bravado, it's a bravado culture. And it's their own subculture, and if you're not part of it, you know, you know, you're not part of it. You don't understand it. They don't want outsiders in their culture. there's subcultures. It's a subculture, and subcultures can be that way. And this one, you know, these guys and gals are tough. They're very tough. They take a lot of spills. They break bones. They have, you know, they got operations. They bounce back. So yeah, I have my knee operated. I'm back on the board, and it doesn't faze them. They don't stop. They're reckless daredevils. But they're committed, and you know, they're a lot of them don't have a lot of money, and you know, it's not a subculture that I, you know, feel comfortable in. It's not my cup of tea. You know, I'm you know, spiritual, non-dual, contemplative, soulful type of culture thing. It's, you know, no death and none of this stuff. But I respect their subculture and understand it's bravado is part of it. It's like surfing culture too. I mean, it's. Everyone has to reinforce in one another, like, hey, you know, don't lose your nerve, don't lose your confidence. And they take a bad spill of tumble. Nobody says anything. They just get up and do it again. And it's not like, you know, there's no bleeding hearts. It's a tough culture, skateboard culture, tough culture. They've got an edge to it. There's a real strong edge to it. A little wacky. It's a little wacky. Okay, so I'm not advocating we turn into, you know, skateboard culture here. Not at all. We're using all of this as grist for the mill, as a metaphor, it's a 360 degree immersion. We're immersed. You know, but let's be a little bit hip here. All right, nothing wrong with being super hip. And I'm trying to, you know, learn the terminology and stuff. I never even heard of an ollie in my life. Until yesterday evening and today, I never even heard of it. Didn't even know what it was. So, you know, time to get a little bit hip. And but we're not going to be, you know, jumping rails probably. Sliding rails, doing dark side on rails or Caspers on rails, whatever they do, Casper to this and that. And it's just insane. Some of the stuff they do is so... You got to hit it so perfect to do it. I mean, it's just amazing. And the risks they take of not hitting it perfectly, they're falling on concrete, going fast, going down concrete stairs. You know, I mean, you're going to get hurt. You're going to get hurt. But these kids are like Gumbies, you know. So, yeah, they get hurt. I don't think they nail it every time. Come on. I mean, this stuff is so technical and difficult. I think snowboarding is a lot safer, isn't it? It's got its own dangers too, people have told me. That's another, so all these subcultures of tough daredevil risk takers, Yeah, they're pretty grungy and pretty, what do you call it? The icons are pretty rough, pretty rough. The graphics and the icons and all this stuff, it's not exactly the cup of tea for non-dualists. But you know, if you respect them and speak their language, you know, they respect you. They're good people. They're good people. The subcultures, the people are good there if you know where they're coming from. But they can be pretty gross and graphic and crass and crude and all that kind of stuff, sure. Yeah, they live on the edge. I mean, the concrete is hard. Concrete is hard. The fall is a hard fall, and they know it. And so they don't put up with nonsense, really. It's do or die for them, right? They have this do or die attitude. And camaraderie, bravado stuff. Anyway, there you go. So being proactive, you have to be aware to be proactive, and you have to be non-aligned and open, 360 degree. Otherwise, you won't see what's happening. You just think we got to defeat these people. You don't understand that no matter what happens, we're in this catastrophe. It's already catastrophic. Like I say, when did the tsunami start? It starts when the earthquake takes place. You know, you can even go back further, the friction, the fault. But from a pragmatic standpoint, we say the tsunami starts when this great undersea earthquake takes place. That's when it starts. It's not when it hits the beach. Most people think it starts when it hits the beach. No, it doesn't. It starts when the earthquake starts, and that energy in the ocean is traveling towards land. And then you know it's going to hit. Once the earthquake happens, you know the tsunami is coming, it's going to hit. And so you have to be proactive and start, if you're wise, you're proactive from that point. Even before that, when you know the frictions, you know a fault is about ready to pop, you know it's going to pop, you start planning even then for the tsunami to hit. You don't wait until the tsunami hits and say, oh gee, a tsunami just hit, what do we do? Yeah, that's not proactive. So we're proactive here. I'm very proactive in this regard. I want the Dharma Kings here. I want them to appear. Okay? I want them to start helping us. I want us to start acknowledging them. I want to start getting acquainted with them. I want miracles to start happening. I want to start flipping the cultural script. So I want people to start waking up and realizing, hey, we need to start practicing some stuff here. Because we're really behind the times here. We're really out of it. You know, our narrow definition of God's grace, just doesn't really serve us anymore. Not that it was all wrong, okay? God's grace is true. God's grace certainly works through Jesus. It certainly works. But we need to widen it out. We need to widen it out. Bigger picture. And see the full, greater extent of God's grace. God's grace is amazing. We didn't have it all, penned in. Don't fence it in. We tried to fence it in for various reasons. Our continuity fear caused us to be pretty stupid, actually. It does that. It makes fools of us all. We have to accept it, repent, and say, yeah, continuity fear has made a fool out of me, but not for long because I'm opening up the Holy Spirit, and pretty soon I won't be a fool anymore. And that's a great outlook to have, right? You can say, yeah, I've been a fool, but I'm not gonna remain a fool. And how bad do you feel then? Not so bad. Say, yeah, I've been a fool, but I'm not gonna remain a fool for long, because I'm gonna get after it now. I'm gonna open my mind, 360 degree cross training, spiritual cross training. Start realizing God's grace is everywhere, and everyone's already saved. Everyone is already enlightened. Everyone's already enlightened. There's no such thing as any one of us going to hell and being annihilated. Everyone is already enlightened, and I've experienced this. I saw everyone truly. I saw the right way that the Holy Spirit gave the vision of Christ. I saw every single one of us is in perfect condition, perfect standing with God, with ourselves, with freedom, with truth. Every single one of us. Not one of us is lost at all. This is a fact. We're all one perfect spiritual family. I saw it as a fact, saw the truth of it. It's absolutely true what Jesus tells us and the Dharma kings tell us. This is the truth. So this idea that there's some are going to go to hell and burn and be annihilated because they didn't make it and all that, this is just ridiculous. It's not true at all. Okay, it's foolishness. Everyone is already enlightened. There may be some that pretend to be damned eternally, sure. But it's just pretense. Just nothing but pretense. Because they don't want to admit that they're not already enlightened. They want to say that they fell from grace. They want to believe in that, which means that they changed an idea in the mind of God, which means they're greater than God. So if they want to believe that, they may go with this illusion of being damned and annihilated. It's just an illusion. It's just a dream. Dream has no effect on our reality whatsoever. So nobody is lost at all. There's no lost sheep at all, actually. We're no sheep at all, really. Everyone's already enlightened. This is a fact, absolute fact. And denying this fact is just mere foolishness. That's all it is. So repent and say, yeah, I've been foolish. I've denied this fact, but I'm not going to remain foolish for long because I'm not accepting this fact. And I'm just going to get acquainted with it. I'm going to get used to it. And pretty soon, it'll just be the natural to me, of course. Everyone's already enlightened. More and more as I look at the world, people, it comes upon me. It's easier to say, I don't even have to look at your body. Why do I look at your body? That's just a pretense. You're pretending not to be enlightened. I know you're already enlightened. You always have been. You never fell from grace at all. I don't need to judge you in the slightest bit. There's nothing to judge. There's nothing to judge. So I've got my spiritual ollie going on. You know, I'm starting to get the hang of it a little bit. it's not easy. I mean, you got to practice. Once you get the hang of it, though, it gets easier and easier. And don't worry about all these so-called leaders of the world. Don't put any faith into them at all. They're old. They're dragging back in the dark stone age, really, as far as their understanding goes. This positivism that they have, spiritual positivism, no. I'm telling you for a fact, everyone, right this instant, this is true, everyone is already enlightened. There's not one of us that's not enlightened. Not one of us. Anything seeming to the contrary is an illusion, a mirage. Wishful thinking, dream, mental projection, pretense, 100% pretense. And we don't have to judge the pretense at all. It's nothing at all. Why do we need to judge it? Why do we need to judge one another? There's nothing to judge. What, my pretense of not being enlightened is better than your pretense? What is that? Does that mean we're not enlightened? We were enlightened, so there's nothing to judge. There's no failure to judge at all. Every one of us is already enlightened. That's it. So what is there to judge? What are we judging? Do we need to judge bodies? For what? What purpose? Serves no purpose at all. Serves no purpose. Seeing bodies actually serves zero purpose. Zero purpose. This is what Jesus tells us in the Course in Miracles. There's absolutely no value. Serves no purpose in seeing bodies. It's completely meaningless. He's absolutely right. And so we can get more and more this way, more and more this way. We don't need to, there's nothing to judge. We don't need to judge bodies. We don't need to judge any beauty contest, pretense contest. It serves no purpose at all. Doesn't change the truth one bit. And that what we need to see is the truth, that we're all enlightened. Nobody fell from grace. It's impossible for us to fall from grace. We're just pretending, that's all. So if I'm going to start leaping up high, I better lose some more weight. you know, these kids, they weigh 120 pounds. Come on. They got like kangaroos. You see them jumping up. The jumps they do are just insane. They're like flying through the air. How do they do that? They're such daredevils. And they're strong. They're lean. They're mean. They weigh 120 pounds. And they're just defying gravity. They're just jumping up like this, like pogo sticks. just springing up, and they skate real fast, and they just do this massive spring up in the air, and they're just like flying over gaps and stuff that just you think, wow. To the street down below. I mean, you know, not only are they leaping over concrete barriers and stuff, that they're also going down to the street below, maybe 10 feet lower than when they took off. And they're landing it, and they're doing flips as they're going, and they're landing it, you know, perfect on the concrete below. Now, my buddy, you know, he broke both his ankles skating. Because, you know, he missed it once, you know, he missed it bad once. So it is intense what they're doing. They're landing it. So I gotta lose some more weight, I guess, or at least get my weight, you know, low as possible, and get strength and start springing up, so I can really leap up in the air. At least a little bit. Maybe I can get do like a 2-inch ollie. You're like, oh, I got the board 2 inches off the ground. That's pretty cool. At least I can leap over a crack then in the sidewalk, right? And some instruction, just oh, you know, skate faster, then jump up in the air and just go right over. Nah, smoothness, all smooth. The idea is to keep it smooth. And these really great street skaters, they just keep it so smooth. It's just poetry in motion, genius in motion here. They're going along in just a suburban a cityscape, you know, concrete and all this stuff, and they're just, you know, just gliding along this bench, gliding along this table, gliding along this concrete wall, this ledge, this planter box, you know, you name it, guardrail, stairs, just leap up on, just glide down the whole handrail like this, and then smoothly land on the pavement and just keep on carving, you know, along. And it's just like a flow. It's just like this unbelievable flow. You can't even believe anyone could do this. But they do it. We can keep a flow through life like that, actually. We can keep this unbelievable, almost seemingly miraculous flow through life when we really get it, you know, how to do this. We certainly can do it. And don't judge, but just don't judge anyone. There's nothing to judge. There's nothing to judge pretense. Why do we need to judge pretending that we're not enlightened? So there's zero purpose. We don't need to see the bodiness at all, really, right? Don't need to see thingness at all. It's part of the pretense, right? So this can dawn upon us, and then we'll be flowing through life like these street skaters flow through a cityscape, city streets. You know, I don't think I've ever seen any of these skaters. I live in the suburbs. I don't live in a city. I've never seen anyone do this, but I kind of like to see it. You know, it would be pretty amazing to see it, actually. The parkour guys are also pretty amazing, who don't just do it through gymnastics. It's extraordinary what they do. Love what they do. Just vaulting over walls and leaping and vaulting and flipping and the stuff they do. Parkour, oh, man. That is really amazing. They're able to leap long distances between skyscrapers. They'll leap from a roof of one skyscraper to the other. You know? I mean, there's daredevils. And they can just do stuff that just you can't believe what they can do. So, amazing stuff goes on here with bodies, right? But what's even more amazing is our ability to mentally flow through this vast pretense here. And the key is, you know, Jesus says forgiveness, but the forgiveness is just no judgment in the first place. The way to forgive is don't judge in the first place. Forgive yourself for judging. Just forgive. Let's each one of us forgive ourselves for judging pretense in the first place, for thinking there was something meaningful to judge. There was nothing at all to judge, nothing meaningful at all to judge about existence, and just forgive ourselves for having ever judged at all, and that's it. And then we will flow through this dream beautifully, actually, just like some Rodney Mullins. We'll be Rodney Mullins, Mullen, street skating through. He wasn't originally a street skater; he was a freestyler on flat ground. Originally, then he transitioned ultimately into street skating. It's a big deal for him. It was, you know, he didn't want to, but he did. And so now we see him, you know, going, doing his thing. Just amazing. And people be amazed how we flow through life. And again, forgive ourselves for having judged, for having thought there's anything to judge at all. Just forgive ourselves for it. And that's the end of it. No more judgment. There's nothing to judge about pretending that we're not enlightened. There's nothing to judge because we are enlightened. Every one of us. And we've always been so. So what is there to judge? What is there to judge? There's nothing to judge, actually. There's nothing to judge. Now, for traditional religious people, they just say, what are you talking about? You know, what did you just say? What did you just do? You know, I say, it's pretty cool, but we're all, yeah, no, but I don't know, how did you get there? And, you know, God said this, and Jesus said this, and the Bible says this, and it doesn't, you can't make it work, you know, but, so I understand, you know, I feel the same way, like a skateboarder now. I'm looking at these street skaters and freestylers, and I'm saying, what are you doing? Rodney, what are you doing? You're blowing my mind, man. I just don't get it. You're doing like 1 foot in 360s, and then you're doing something where you go backwards and you just flip it and just, what? Don't you get vertigo? Come on. He's just spinning like a top. I don't understand what he's doing. But it all makes it look easy. Not falling. Wow. Cool. Very cool. Very nice. Love it. Let's see if we can't at least get a little feel for something, huh? So, I have sympathy for religious people, because they say there's absolutely nothing to judge at all, and that's the answer. They just feel so stuck, like, I can't do that. It's like, I feel like I can't do this freestyle street skating at all. Not at all. Not at all. I can't even do one move that they do. Not even one. Not even one. That's, so I know the feeling. I feel for you. Traditional religious people, I feel for you. Because you feel you just can't go there at all. You can't do this at all. But there is a way. I've done it. There is a way. There is a way. It takes certain, basically, you have to understand that God didn't create death at all, or sickness or vulnerability at all. You have to have some basic faith in this, and faith that despair is not, just cannot transform us at all. There's certain experiences you have that change your outlook, fundamentally change your outlook. And then from there, you begin to add on to that. God created us as spirit and truth, didn't create bodies at all. Did not create death at all. So where did it come from? You know, we do that. Well, you start really, you know, gradually you start changing your outlook, changing your belief system. And it's a gradual thing. It's not easy. I understand that, absolutely. Like, how do you become a great street skater? Well, it's not easy. It takes, you know, it's desire and commitment and hard work and great attitude and all that stuff. But you can do it. So you can change your belief system from one of believing in damnation and vicarious atonement and sacrifice and all this kind of stuff and judgment and God's going to judge us and some will make it, some will, to realizing no judgment at all. There's never been anything to judge at all. And forgive yourself for ever thinking there was something to judge. And then guess what? You will realize that we're all enlightened, and you will feel this great feeling of that struggle and regret have left the building, have left your building, left your home, and not to never will they return. They're gone, without a trace, no scars, no scars. You have no scars. You have no regrets, and no echoes and no scars of it. You feel flawless. You feel the bliss and the flawlessness and perfection of reality, and there's no scars. You have no regrets and no scars. That's how you'll feel. And that's just one simple recognition away. There's nothing to judge at all. Never has been. Never. Anywhere. And we just need to forgive ourselves for having ever judged, and that's the end of it. All regrets vanish. All regrets vanish. One insight settles it all. Forgiveness settles it all. Forgiving ourselves settles it all. And then we can easily be friends with Jesus. We can go skate with Jesus. Go spiritually skating with Jesus through the streets of our mind. And it's no problem. We don't wipe out. We hit every reverse Casper manual primo 360 kick. Well, you know, fakey this and that. We hit it all. We hit it all. No spills. No spills. It's all smooth. A fakey primo dark side Casper. You know, reverse. Reverse wheelie. Saran wrap. I'll have to learn all the names of all those tricks and get a kick out of it. Shove kick 360, this and that, and double flip. And there's all the vert stuff, you know, the lingo for that. I'm not going to tackle that right this moment. Yeah. So keep your sense of humor. It's not easy for people who've believed in judgment to just hear, oh, there's no judgment at all. He's like, what? But this is the truth. This is the truth. It has to be stated. It has to be acknowledged. It has to be experienced. There's no other way. There is no other way. And we can't fool around anymore catering to the old way. You know, we cannot. We're in an absolute disastrous crisis. The tsunami is coming. Tsunami of mental illness is coming, all right, and that this affects us because we don't want others to suffer. We don't, you know, we say, hey, so we have to see it the way it really is and showcase it so they can start getting with it. They say, hey, maybe, you know what, it is possible. I don't need to be mentally ill. These people here, they're not mentally ill at all. I can see it. I don't have to wipe out. I can see this. Look what they're doing on the skateboard. Wow, they're not wiping out. Wow, that's amazing. Well, I can see it's possible. So it means I can do it. I just need to train properly. That's right. We can forgive ourselves and by recognizing there's nothing to judge at all. Judging nothing is what? No judgment at all, really. There's never been any judgment. We've never really judged anything at all, actually. Pretended to do so, but so just forgive ourselves for even imagining or pretending that we could judge, there's anything to judge, and that we judged anything at all. And a pretend fall is not a fall at all. So what do we need to judge? Everybody's pretending to fall. Do we need to pay any attention, judging all this pretend falling? No. Forgive ourselves for ever thinking that there was anything to judge, believing there's anything at all to judge, that any relevancy whatsoever to what we are. None of this has the slightest relevance to what we are. Everything that we're judging here, zero relevance to what we are. So as far as meaning goes, it's zero, nothing, no meaning. So judging no meaning is making us feel crazy, you know. That's what Jesus tells us in the Course in Miracles. My meaningless thoughts are having me see a meaningless world. And this seeing a meaningless world makes us fearful. That's what Jesus tells us. So it gradually helps us recognize this. Course in Miracles. Get with it. You know, realize there's this very advanced teaching in the world. Very advanced. Okay. Way more sophisticated than the Bible teaching. Way more sophisticated. Way more technical. Way more detailed. Much, much clearer. Right? Nothing, no disrespect for the Bible, because there's great teaching in it. Okay, but this is way, way, way more sophisticated and clearer. Way more. It's like street skating, freestyle skating with ollies compared to pre-ollie. It's like post-ollie and pre-ollie. You know, it's just all virtually incomparable. It really is so much more advanced than it used to be in the 60s and early 70s. It's just night and day, night and day. So the Holy Spirit's given us this amazing tool of comparison here, that, you know, and be hip about it. Why not? Why not? You got to find some way to get truly hip to what's going on right now, and in a hurry. So we're doing this, and we're doing it on the 29th of August, and just laying it out for everybody here very clearly. And tomorrow I'm going to start jumping, trying to jump as high as I can and continue my balancing work, and I'll give some new exercises. I'll try to jump up and down on my board, baby, and I'll figure it out. I'll figure out some things. There's got to be a way. The Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit's, you know, when you listen to the Holy Spirit, there's going to be a way. Holy Spirit will find a way to get me to succeed. And to get us to succeed. Very great. Okay, that's it for this one.